Thank you. Oh, so many people here. I think it's, I know, a lot of people. So thank you very much. Thank you for my talk, From Farm to Cloud. I'm gonna explain a little bit what can we do for the farmers, okay? So first of all, who I am. So I'm from Madrid, Spain. Many people who is there, but well, I mean, working in IT for 15 years. I'm not a DevOps architect, but I know. I've been playing with your tools, like Terraform, Ansible, well, many pretty cool tools. So I'm gonna explain you a little bit what I learned and why agriculture is happy to have us, okay? Also, well, I have, my family have farms also in a state in Spain, but well, the disclaimer is basically, I know very little about agriculture, but I know how we can help them, okay? So that's what I'm gonna do. First of all is why agriculture needs us, why the farmers, why the companies who work in agriculture need us. Second is how we implement DevOps. This is very general, but maybe could help you. And finally, what we learn about DevOps in agriculture, because well, it's not the same industry that in banking and so on, okay? So this is, I think many people don't know about this, but well, right now in the world we are a lot of people, more than 2 billion people, I don't know how much. But basically, right now, we need food, a lot of food, and every year is more. Countries like China or India is increasing out of the population, and basically we need more fields, but the problem with the climate change, basically we need less space to plant. So it's having a lot of problems, agriculture, and that is very tricky. So that's why we are here, the IT people, to help these guys, okay? First of all, which is my company? My company is Syngenta. Okay, this is one of the biggest agriculture companies. Okay, it's the first one in crop rotation, the third one in seeds. We provide seeds to the farmers, and also, well, we have a lot of presence in China, okay? Another cool thing about that is basically we are moving to digital. So basically, we are providing many digital services for the farmers that is in the run of CropWise, okay? But well, there are many things. If you want more information, just go to CropWise.com, okay? Okay, and the need for cloud technology. So why agriculture need us a lot? When I mean a lot, it's many, many times they need our help. So, well, basically, well, the first thing is just to point is that basically they don't care about us. They don't know what to do. Basically for them is that, okay, I have, I don't know. Who knows something about agriculture here? Something? Well, most than me. More than me, that's for sure. Okay, so basically for me, if I go to my family town, they ask me to fix, the, I don't know, their computer, their phone and these kind of things. So they don't know what we do here. Okay, so basically, and why? Because basically they're too busy for their staff. So they have to plant crops, they have to manage cows and many things. The second thing is that basically they prefer to spend time in their things and not in a computer. That's, I know that basically is very typical, okay, outside our industry. The third thing is basically for them, when we say about cloud, they only think about weather forecast. Okay, so that's pretty bad, but this thing happens, okay? And the last thing is about, well, they prefer to speak with plants that with ChatGPT, that's for sure, okay? So, well, I'm that, and when I go to my hometown, I'm that guy, okay? The IT crowd. But apart from this, what can we do to help farmers? Okay, so in agriculture, I think in the last 5 years or 10 years, basically in all the industry, basically, they have emerged a lot of data-driven services, and basically we are doing that. So basically we are gathering a lot of data from the farmers, from the fields, for the weather, for many things, and basically we are creating services around that data. Okay, and basically with that, we can help the farmers just to increase the profitability. And basically, that means more food for everyone, okay? And some examples that we can say about this is basically, as I said before, we can increase the production using fewer resources and less land, okay? Because we can, I don't know, help them just to say when to plan or what to plan, okay? We also give advanced recommendations, like as I said, for, I don't know, specific seeds that basically are better for this field, for this specific part of UK, and so on, okay? And also, well, we have a lot of data that it came from satellites, so we can give in real time monetization of their fields. So then they don't have to go to the field and see what is happening. We can show them in the device, meanwhile they are in the reference, okay? And the final thing is this very, I'm working on it right now, is basically we have machine learning models that basically can identify diseases in the crops. And well, these are very samples, okay? As I said. And well, now we said about why agriculture needs the IT industry and why the cloud is the right place to do it. Because basically, for creating these services, basically we need the latest technologies that basically give us the best performance. As always, working with data is sometimes overwhelming, whereas maybe you know about big data, this kind of thing. Basically, we need more resources, we need more space, we need more power in general, okay? So basically, we need the cloud, okay? And basically, the cloud providers is the ideal place for that, okay? Basically, with that, and that basically, before we cannot do that, is basically we can store unlimited data, okay? Before this, maybe we can store, I don't know, 1 year. Right now, we can store 20, 30 years of data. We can go to the past and see what happens. 10 years ago, that thing was impossible. Another thing is basically we can experiment and use the latest artificial intelligence algorithms, like ChatGPT. For example, some months ago, we have a hackathon using ChatGPT, and basically we figured out ways in order to use this algorithm to help farmers, okay? So this is something that basically is in the cloud. It's very difficult for me and with my laptop create something similar, where there are open source projects, but it's not easy for a small company to use these latest technologies. And Amazon basically is, or Azure, is very easy for us to work with these services. Basically it's plug and play. And the final thing is about, for example, another example is the automation of machinery. This is, well, this requires a lot of power because basically you are receiving gigabytes of data for a specific truck, a specific machinery, and basically with the old computers in your company, it's very difficult. But with the cloud computing, you can scale. Okay, sure. So it's a challenge before, but right now it's easy for doing that, okay? And basically, why Sanjeta was an early adopter? Because basically, you want to be the leader and you want to be in the forefront of R&D, basically you have to spend money in the technology. And basically, we were here in Amazon, I think, since 2017. I think we have to be in the top, basically, of our companies. I don't know our competitors, but in our case, basically, we were in Amazon for many things. All the things we start, basically, go to the cloud or to Amazon. And basically, this provides us, as you may know, basically, scalability, flexibility. We can, you know, more or less maintain the cost and these kind of things, okay? And a big thing that I think I have to mention is that go to the market faster. Okay, this is very important. As I mentioned before, working with ChatGPT is good. You can do it in your home, but basically a company is not the same. And if you go with Amazon that provides you the services, that service, very easy for you, you can innovate much, much easier and faster, and that's always good. Okay, so that's mostly what I know about agriculture, what we can do. Now, I think it's, for this audience, it's much easier. Some things we know about DevOps, okay, so this is about how we implemented DevOps, okay? Maybe differ about your companies or projects, but I think it's good to know, okay? So why need DevOps for the cloud? That's the first thing. So basically, I'm a developer, as I said, a solution data solution architect. So we don't have enough skills to know what have to do with the infrastructure, how we deploy to the Kubernetes, as the previous presenter says. So it's very difficult for us to do this kind of things that basically we're saying today. Okay? So this is the first thing. The second thing is that DevOps is not only about putting this in production and running it, it's about designing and building a thing that basically works in the time. Okay? So you have to manage the services, you have to monitorize them, you have to give the proper support, and well, for me this is not easy. Okay? And well, these tools like GitHub, Terraform, Ansible, Kubernetes, these kind of things, basically these things are tools that basically help us, but basically are not easy to maintain. Okay? And well, you need someone who know about that, and well, it's hard. Okay? And DevOps is going to help that part. Okay? And the final thing is about DevSecOps. Okay, about security. So we need specific people who know about security. And basically, I don't know about those kind of things. I don't have to care about them, but someone will help me. Okay. And basically, that's why we need DevOps. Okay. So this is I split into parts. Basically, the bad way and the good way. So the first thing we do is in the bad way. So basically, what we did is using the old-fashioned way of doing things, so we have a specific department for DevOps. Okay, so basically we resist to this change about DevOps because DevOps is not only about tools, it's not about technology, it's about doing things in another way. So basically we have a department who is DevOps, we ask them, okay, you have to do it, raise a ticket, I put what I need, they deliver it to me, okay? But it's like outsourcing, okay? And well, sometimes it works, but in the end, you are going to have friction, you are going to have problems, okay? And basically, you work in silos and it's not good. Another thing is about experience, about tools, infrastructure as code, automation, these kind of things, okay? So my team doesn't know about this. If you have to go to the DevOps and ask for them, maybe they don't know what are the specific things about your project, and sometimes, well, they don't automate everything, okay? And the last one is about feedback, okay? If you work in different teams, you have to speak, by mail, by chat, and this feedback is not good enough. Sometimes it's not fast, and well, it's not easy to improve over time, okay? And well, maybe you know about the Spotify model. It's about, it's a new way of doing things. We started this some years ago. It's about how we can do this in an agile way. Okay, so instead of having different teams, what we do is, okay, we have a DevOps guy. We are gonna put in our team, include in all of our meetings, like, the rest of the team, like a front-end developer, back-end developer, DevOps guy will help me with everything, okay? And basically, what is going to happen? Basically, everything is going to run much faster. I'm going to have many time. I'm gonna focus in the specific part that my product is based. For example, my service needs more automation because I have to deploy many times. If my DevOps guy is my team, we can do it much faster. Okay. Also, well, we have these kind of things that I don't really know a lot about guilds, about chapters, these kind of things. Okay. But well, maybe someone from Agile will know more about that. Okay. Perfect. Okay. And well, this is something. Oops, I'm gonna have a lot of time. Okay. Maybe I can spend more time in lessons. Okay. I'm gonna say something about something I understood about the farm, working with agriculture. I think about DevOps. Okay. Maybe I'm gonna have some problems saying this, but well. Disclaimer, basically, this is my experience, this is what I did. Maybe you don't understand what I say, other times not, but I think it's important to know. So the first thing is to be open. So what means to be open? So, and this is very important for agriculture. If you go for other industries, maybe it's different, but agriculture, basically, if you go to a farmer and say, okay, I want to use this service, I want to pay for an app, basically he's going to tell you, okay, this season is going to be very difficult because we have some problems. Come next year and basically we can start together and see if it works. So basically what that means, basically it's a long-term thing. Okay, and what that means for us, basically is that we need something that basically is going to be there for a long term, for years. We are not saying about months or 1 year, 2 years. We have to maintain the same service for 10 years. And basically, be open is going to help us for that. Okay? And how can we be open? Okay? Being open is not only about open source, it's basically use open standards. Okay? This means, for example, use HTML, we saw before about Kubernetes for orchestration. So using this kind of open standards will help us to be in the industry for 10 years. We don't have to change our product. Okay. The second thing is about how we build the things. Okay. For me, using, at least my case, using open source libraries, like for example React, for example Spring Boot, or other things, but that has a lot of contributors, will help me, to be on the field for many time, okay? I don't remember how much, but I think Spring Framework has been for 15 years. Postgres, for example, 30 years. Kubernetes, I think they have, okay, sorry. 10 years, more than 10 years, so this is not easy. This is not easy if you go for a service. We can go to Google and see how is the timeline of Google with their products. This is kind of things that I haven't tested a lot about Google Cloud. It's about maybe tomorrow I won't have that service in Google. Maybe yes, but maybe not. I'm not sure. But with this kind of open source, with this open mind, it's much difficult to happen. Okay? Sorry. Another thing that I learned is about if you go to the cloud, try to use the services that is based on open technologies. So I'm working with data. I used to work, for example, with Kinesis data streams just to have data. Okay, it's a very good technology, it's cheap, but what happens if I have to leave Amazon? Because, and in China, for example, Amazon closed, what can I do? Maybe it happens that I can make a small change and it's easy for me, but maybe it's not. So, if you go, for example, to have a database, go to Postgres, you have the Postgres services in all the cloud providers, like RDS, you have the same in Azure, SQL, so try to use that, okay? And the final thing is, if you go to open source project, please go and use someone that is from an open foundation, like Apache of Linux. This is very important. The next slide is gonna give you an example. Okay, sorry, please, don't see this. This part, sorry. Well, I didn't know you can hear as a sponsor, but. So, this happens very recently about HashiCorp. Many of you know about Terraform. I know something about Terraform, but when I see this, I was very disappointed because for me, HashiCorp was, the kind of company that his open source culture was an example. But 1 month ago, we saw that basically they closed the license. And in my case, basically, I have to figure out, okay, my company gives great produce for the farmers, but I'm right with the license. Maybe yes, maybe not. In the case of this FSBSL license, it's very big, so could be. So in my case, what I'm gonna do, I'm not really sure if it's going to work. We have to see about this. So open tofu. Holy shit, tofu. I know. They don't have other name. Holy shit. open tofu is like, I don't know, I like meat. I have to eat now tofu. I don't know. Whatever. The same thing happens with Elastic. The same thing with Mongo. Well, in this case, who is using Mongo? It's like this meme. So they closed many time ago, but well, no one cares about Mongo. You have better solution like Postgres. Okay. The same with Elastic. Okay. So I don't know. You have to be very careful. Okay. Be very careful. Be open, but at the same time you have to take care of these kind of things. Okay. The second thing is about FinOps. This is very important. If you see the margins of the agriculture, of the farmers, if you ask them how much money they have in benefits, it's very small. Okay, so when you go and create a product for them, you have to be very careful with the pricing. And sometimes, I buy a startup, and basically with this wonderful product, but basically they're losing a lot of money. And sometimes it's because, they hire a lot of people, other times because of the infrastructures, okay? So when you create a services, you have to have a FinOps mindset, okay? What does it mean? It's basically you have to, when you create an architecture, you also have to think about money, about how can we create a product that basically is going to be good, but also is not going to cost a lot with the time, okay? And basically we have several ways of implementing FinOps. Basically, I've been using many times in Amazon cost allocation tags and this kind of thing. That basically, when you create, using Terraform is very easy, for example, you create a bucket, you create a database, and you put a tag, and you do the same for all the projects. You go to the Cost Explorer application, and it's going to be very easy. Okay, this is my bill. I'm gonna see, okay, which is my cost? Holy shit. This time, I spend a lot in DocumentDB, a lot of S3, a lot of whatever. So this kind of things has to be done every month, every day. And we have a lot of tools to help us in order to maintain the cost under some kind of budget, okay? Another thing is about alert and dashboard, okay? I didn't do it maybe after the 6 months, but these things happen, okay? Maybe, you have a lot of, the business people is very happy with your time, but, 2 or 3 months later, they receive an email from they receive an email and saying, how much money is costing me this? Okay, it's $10,000, $100,000 per month. You didn't tell me this, that it's going to be very costly. Okay, basically, alerts, dashboards, these kind of things, is very easy to use, okay? And the last part about FinOps mindset is about being productive, okay? I think it's very important. I remember when I was part of the well-architected framework in Amazon, and basically this is one of the pillars, or one basically the good thing about knowing these pillars in Amazon is about being productivity. So a good way to do this is, if I go to the bill every month and see, okay, I'm spending this part, this money, this part, that money, and see how can I improve, okay? And we have plenty of ways to reduce costs, for example, reserves instance, spot instance, use these tools that has Kubernetes for scaling your resources. If you are in the app on QA, you can switch off. That's okay. We don't care about QA, so we can do it, okay? And these are some tools we use in Syngenta, Cloud9, KubeCost, InfraCost, also CloudWatch, I think. Oh no, there is, just to say, because I read some weeks ago, there is a web page, but basically it's a quiz about the Amazon icons. You can find in Google, okay? You will have a quiz and basically they will tell you, they will put you an icon of Amazon service and you have to figure out what it is. But I think this is CloudWatch. The third one, automation, okay? Here we have Pulumi, we have the other one. We have many tools that basically can help us to automate, okay? And this is very important. I have seen, I have been in many, many projects that like a lot to go to the Amazon console and do things manually. And when I see that, they put me in my nerves because I have a lot of problems with this kind of way of working, okay? So we have to do that. We have to automate. This is our duty. This is how we should do things. And basically, how can we do that? Because, okay, maybe you are, in a big project that has been for 10 years. Maybe you are starting. So we have some tips to do. So the first one is start small. And this is, I think, the best approach is that, don't go to the Kubernetes thing and automate it. Maybe, going to Kubernetes to deploy things is not the first thing. Maybe what you should do, for example, is to automate test. Go to GitLab, go to CircleJ, create a small workflow, and basically create a small bash script that basically execute PyTest or execute whatever framework you have, okay? Start small, then with the time you can, like I'm doing, for example, that have everything as a code. I use Terraform, I use Liquidbase, I use the same for testing. We have also SonarQube, everything is automated. But I know if you are starting, just start small. Okay? As I said, everything is code. Okay? There are many things we can do. Infrastructure, we have Pulumi, we have Terraform, configuration, as I said, Ansible, Chef. For testing, we have the same database I mentioned about Liquidbase, we have also Flyway, many things. So it's very easy to automate. The problem is that we have to spend time, okay, on it. Another thing is about over-engineering. So sometimes, basically, I'm a developer. I have been coding in Python, in Java, in Rust, in Go. I have a experience. I was in a company that basically, okay, half time. So, and basically I go and you make a script in Go just for copying a file. Don't do it. You can do it with a simple bash script, okay? And the final thing is transparency, okay? Just share everything with your team. Sorry, but there are some things. One important thing is to be developer-centric, okay? Just have it in mind, you are DevOps. You are there for helping your developers and try to do that. You have to help the developer, not the opposite, okay? You have some tools that you can use, this IDP, this internal development framework, like Backstage, that you can have in order to have a central repository for the tools, so you don't have to spend time having meetings. They go directly to Backstage and see what you have. You have created this pipeline, you have created this testing workflow, whatever. You put all the DevOps tools you have, you put there and they will know about them. The final thing is development environments. I've been using the container. I encourage you to use it. So please try to use them. And finally, observability, okay? I think this is very important just to have everything. If something happens, you have the metrics, you have the logs. No, try to spend that time on that. Okay? Okay. Have something more, but I think it's enough. Okay? So, sorry, thank you. Maybe can help. If you have more questions, just I'll be there for some hours. So, thank you, everyone.